General Giuseppe Morabito is in the room. So we now move on to the Africa part. And so again, we,
Thank you.
I thank you very much, General Gonem, as always. And it's we totally depend on you in organizing such a series of scholars and practitioners. So thank you again. And we now go on to this sub-Saharan Sahel part. We have three speakers. First of all, Brigadier General Giuseppe Morabito, now Director of the Rome Capital Civil Protection Department, and he will talk about Libya, about its prolonged conflict and its repercussions on both European and African sides. So, here, yeah. General Morabito, thank you again for overcoming technical issues, and we're happy to ha having you
Seems
here.
to be okay, seems to be.
Thank you. Thank you
Yeah.
very much. And it's your turn. And my...
Yes, thanks a lot for the invitation. Good morning from the Eternal City, the most beautiful city of the world. It's early morning in Rome, and just move. Sorry for Syed, I had no chance to listen to all the speeches of Syed, but I know him, so he is for sure moderate, but Turkey, so it's okay, it's normal. So I hope you can see my presentation. Please confirm.
Yes.
Yes. So this is my presentation today. I hope to stay in the 20 minutes that we have today. And first of all, as I like always, I want to introduce the area. This is the area. Libya is in the top down. You see. Mediterranean Sea, you need what does it mean, Mediterranean? Mediterranean is in the middle of the earth. And if you look, my country is in the middle of the earth, Mediterranean, Med is in middle, Terra is earth. So, and you see where is my city, where I am now. In the city, in the center of Mediterranean, where is Italy? So when something happened in the sea, in this water, we are very interested because we live in the center of the country. In two words, 10 years after the 2011 revolution that overview Gaddafi has been resolved. The war was been resolved. In October 2020, the ceasefire between the two main warring parties. For one side, the Marshal Haftar, on the other hand, the government, but the Marshal Haftar is important, but he leads the armed wing of the House of Representatives, HOR, in Tobruk. That if you remember the map, is near the sea. And the government of national country, GNA, remain fragile. So what is, does it mean? There is no peace. And the country is a potential result of energy riches, is undermined by parochial and denied the ruling class. This is the main problem of Libya. What I want to say is that it is important strategically, the location of Libya in the center of the Mediterranean basin, because it's a source of trade, power, and a source of its troubles. The foreign powers, and we will see in a few moments which one, seek to establish footholds on the ground, boots on the ground or foots on the ground. These foreign powers are showing no willingness to comply with the request of Haftar. Haftar in this moment is in advantage in the conflict, and the GNA to withdraw the proxy forces from January 2013. So the Libyan in 2013 and 23. That could set the country to a new precipice. If I don't go, it will be a problem. Meanwhile, both Libyan sides have been remaining setting the stage for resumption of a more intensive conflict. Where is no peace, the two parties not having conflict, they are rebuilding their logistics. This is very important, Benjamin. In any peace, there is a rebuilding of the, when is a is a moment of peace, no fire, no combat activity, but it's a rebuilding of peace. And there is a terrible humanitarian disaster and in this moment in the area, and this could become worse. Because an unsettled Syria caught up the persistent civil war, destabilized North Africa, this is the point, and generated uncontrolled migration flow and terrorism threats in Europe. We have to start to connect. What is the connection between North Africa and Europe? The uncontrolled migration and the possible to have terrorists in the middle of immigrants is always this what is the problem. External powers and non-state actors have exploited the prolonged diplomatic absence in the United States and Europeans. Union, what does it mean? In the last year, most probably, the Americans were not very interested in the area, also because of the Chinese virus, this virus from Wuhan, created a problem. So the population in Europe was looking more to internal problem than external. No, we're not looking south. And the recent history show that especially the US diplomatic involvement is key for restoring balance to the country and warning the destructive influences. If Americans don't use their soft power, their power in the area, the other country can gain advantage in this area. The external actors are drawn to Libya for geopolitical, economic, and ideological reasons. This is important. Economic and geopolitical. Ideological is less. In the central Mediterranean basin and close to Italy, Libya, deep water, this is very important. Ports provide a chance to control a substantial sea area and vital trade routes. The more than at least one third of the commercial shipping in the world is in the Mediterranean Sea. This is very important. And if you have a port in the area, you control the area because you get refueling, you can send your submarine, your warship there. This is very important. And these harbors are in North Africa, in Libya, no, not only Libya. Libya can also, this is the pain point. One there is another point. Libya can also be an important energy power. It's one of the world's most productive oil fields, and as well as natural gas and solar potential power. But while a rich energy resource, Libya needs to import everything. So Libya has the capacity to sell oil through Italian company. There is a pipeline that moved from Libya to Sicily in the central Mediterranean. It's called Green Stream. The owner of this pipeline is an Italian company, Eni. But Libya gained money from this, selling oil, but they have to buy all food, weapons, electricity, whatever is needed for reconstruction, they have to buy. And in the post-2001 civil war, is important because the war, the civil war, has destroyed all the infrastructure of Libya. There is nothing that works in Libya. So now I hope to have given a picture of the situation, and I want to show you the actors. The actors are these two men. At the very beginning, and I heard that Syed was telling something about the Americans in the area. Donald Trump was not very interested in the area, and there was not an intervention. Usually the Democratic have the more activity of intervention, are more active and more like more intervention. If you have seen at the news of this morning, we had the information that there were bombing in Syria. So connect the Republican, less active with soft power, Democratic as usual, more intervention. So, and this night, yesterday, in Syria was the first bombing. So we will see what happened in Libya with a change from a Republican to a Democratic. These two guys took advantage, both of them, from the absence of American, because Russian have support one of the side we will see later, and supporting one of the side they have advantage in some ports, air base, and the Chinese want to enter and to rebuild some of the harbor of the port in the north of Libya, because if they have a port, rebuilt a port, they make a reconstruction, it's a business, because they Libyan can pay with the petrodollars. But they also have the chance to control a very important port, point of starting point, entering point, like you, as you like in the north of Africa. So it's the arrival of the Chinese of the north of Africa. If they participate to the reconstruction, it's important. Mr. Stoltenberg, NATO. As you know, NATO was the main actor when was the time to overthrow Gaddafi. Now NATO is not a clear position in the point all the nation move in alone, but it's not a clear indication of what will be the following idea of NATO, but NATO is interested in the peace of North Africa. We will see later. This is Europe. Mr. Borrell, High Representative for Foreign Affairs of Europe. And what he say? That for Europe is important to stop the flow of arms. When you see of this Operation Irini, it is a naval operation that is still working in the Mediterranean Sea. And this is the operation that doesn't work, in my opinion. This is absolutely my opinion. Because this operation was fought at the very beginning to stop the flow of weapons in Libya, to support the part in conflict, but it was not working. Now it's inside, but the problem is that the ships of Irini, they can expect a ship coming in the area only if a owner, the sending nation of a ship agree. So if you don't agree, you don't can ship, and for sure, Turkey, I heard the Syed speaking of Turkey, will never respect this rule. Turkey is the main problem in the Mediterranean Sea and the main problem in North Africa. We will see later why. Turkey has a strange policy, and I use this picture because I want to show you that Turkey is still a NATO member, but is not respecting all the rule of NATO. But in this moment, there is no discussion internally on NATO if Turkey can be sent out or where to accept their presence, but they don't respect the rule. And this is a big issue. There is an old Latin sentence. It's better to have with you a bad friend than a good enemy. In this moment, we have inside of alliance a bad friend. And now coming back, Licia, as I said, I want to move a little bit west, has also become the locus of ideological competition over political Islam between Turkey and Qatar on one end, and Arab Quartet of Egypt, United Emirates, Emirates, Saudi Arabia, and Bahrain. It's very important that you look at this, because it's, look at the nation, because look at the nation, because we will look at a photo in a few minutes that we explain you what is happening in the area. Geopolitical competition has intensified in the recent months. Turkey, as I had probably said, is supporting a GNA, they are taking the control of the Al Watiya air base. Sorry for my Arabic. If I'm not good, Syed will say better with me. And where are the F-16 that plane, but also based on the future of Misurata naval base. Again, Misurata naval base. Turkey want a base in the north of Africa. And another point, during the war, and this is a big issue for a NATO country, thousands of Syrian fighters that are sort of terrorist task force were fighting in Libya. This is an indication of the expansionism of foreign policy of Turkey. And coming in Africa from Sudan to Somalia, Somaliland, and all the territory in the center of Africa, south of Sahel, also in the Sahel, Turkish established embassy, and the Turkish airline has established the 54 airline destination. Just to give you an example, at the beginning of intervention of the war, or intervention in the war in Libya of Turkey, there were a lot of flights from Istanbul and Ankara to Tripoli. And for sure, my friends, I don't think that there were thousands of Turkish going on holiday in Libya during this period. Probably there were other people on this plane. And at the fair, when the government of Tripoli won, or at least had the advantage, we had, was traced a lot of flights, a charter flight to Turkish Airlines from Tripoli to Azerbaijan, Baku. And I don't think so, but the Libyan at that time were going on holiday in Azerbaijan after their war. So if we want to discuss a little bit, it should be the topic or the task for another conference. What are doing these people flying on the charter of Turkish Airlines? But why? Because Erdogan is trying to distract the public opinion of Turkey from severe domestic problems. And he is also giving explained recent provocation to Italy, Cyprus, Greece, Israel, and Egypt. And okay, and Syed can tell you something more about this kind of progression in from his mother country. I repeat, this is a very bad approach for a NATO member country. On the rival side, again, Egypt and the UAE and Russia support Haftar. Don't forget UAE in this moment. Egypt from the other side, because Egypt, and Syed can tell you better than me, has historical ties with the Libyan eastern coastal region of Cyrenaica. Egypt want to what increase its influence, because also a million of Egyptian workers go in this area of Libya. Don't forget that during the conflict, Egypt, the president of Egypt several times, the general several times said, If the forces of the government of Tripoli arrive to this point, this red line, Egypt will enter in the territory of Libya. But it's not good. The UAE seek to weaken the Muslim Brotherhood. This is another problem around the world, including Libya, and seek access to the port of Benghazi, October, to augment its influence in Mediterranean Sea. Also the UAE intend to enter in the Mediterranean Sea, and because they want to influence also Middle East and South Africa, because they have a lot of money, a lot of company, a lot of budget, they have to implement the use of this budget. And okay, as I said, the Russia seek the access to the energy sources, ports and naval base in the Mediterranean, because now it's difficult for them, and have a contract and sell arms in change of oil of the market of oil. So Moscow receive access to strategic location, military bases, such as in Egypt, and valuable economic resources, such in Sudan. So Russia is in Egypt, Russia is in Sudan. All these, they are fighting on the boots on the ground of Libya, an indicator of the interest in all Africa. These two countries important. Africa, like elsewhere, Russia also exploits local social instability to attempt to build influence. This is very important. All these actors, please consider this sentence, prefer an instable Libya. A unified Libya with a single government that may not be dependent from the support of the other nation, or they can be supported by a democratic country, can jeopardize their influence and the physical presence. This is very important. So I don't expect in a near future peace in Libya. Remember, a few minutes ago, I was telling you, look at the country, Ibrahim Accord, and the country are Israel and United States, but the two countries very important are Bahrain and UAE. Remember, in Bahrain, UAE, good relation with Syria and Libya, with Russia and Libya, but sign this agreement. So just to show you the complexity of the area. This is the great success of Trump. Probably he was not, at the beginning, was not considering the capacity of this success, but it's a big, very big success. But this success match a little bit with the alliance in Libya. As UAE is allied with Russia, in this moment is signing with the United States of America and with Israel. Bahrain is important because it's a little country, probably you know in the map. It's a completely connected, dependent from the agreement with Saudi Arabia. Bahrain never does anything without the agreement of Saudi Arabia. So most probably, if Bahrain is in this agreement, in the near future, we will see other, also Saudi Arabia, liking this agreement. Don't forget that yesterday, the new president of the United States of America had his first speech, telephone speech, with the king of Saudi Arabia. Peace in Middle East, this is important, and this is willing, if we have a peace in the Middle East, probably we will have more interest, more stability, more flow of money, but we, after the war in Iraq, we see there has not been any war in the Middle East, but the country are fighting in Africa. Let's move to a European country. We are most interested in suppressing terrorism and migration flow. And for sure, as access of energy, but this is also a Japanese problem, access of energy. So it's not only a problem of Italy. But lacking common strategy, Europe largely remains reactive to Libya developments. With division among Brussels and Berlin and above Paris, we are causing in France and Rome, European countries have adopted different and sometimes outright competition and contradictory approach to Libya. The two essential teams that are relation with Russia and persisting distance are unknown, will require serious work and verification by Berlin, Paris, and Rome, toward Washington and Moscow. And for sure, Beijing. On the other hand, the Berlin distance is on the strategic autonomy of Europe is very strange because the president of France wants this strategic autonomy. Also, he works in this direction with the help of the building of European pillar because of the future election. He wants to give a big sentence, a big statement before of election. But this match a lot with what the president of the chancellor or Angela Merkel is doing. Also because she is going to be replaced. Moving to China, it was a strategic exuberance over the last past 25 years has been favored by the West. What I want to say, in Africa, there is a laxity in Africa, confused the concentration of Middle East event with the growth of radical Islamism. This is a big problem. At the same time, the euphoria over the integration of the Sudan has made Europe forget the persisting and underlying Russian factor. Neo-imperialism feed on national roots and also events on the case of Turkey. Unfortunately, we don't read the equation in Europe. This is a big problem. And Turkey is taking advantage of this. Anyway, this is another point that is important during the pandemic. The North-South relation has many positive aspects, especially for energy, and because of energy and because we had found a lot of gas in the waters of Egypt. And this is a good point for Egypt in the future. And Egypt is the most populous country of Africa. So, well, 100 million of Egyptian, 100 million Egyptian will have advantage on this, and it is very important for us. This trend must have seen in a positive light because we fuel development and could continue with new sources in European markets. Given retail excessive dependence of the Russian sources. So if Europeans find in the north of Africa some gas, some oil, some power basin, is very important because we don't look anymore at Russia. And Russia will change its policy in the area. Just to tell you, look at right now, what is the situation? Now Europe receives gas from Africa, but in this moment, also if you consider, look at my country, this is transit country to Europe, the gas arrive from Libya, Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, entering in Spain, entering in Italy, in Sicily with the Green Stream, but also from Turkey and from Greece, and then again in Italy, going in direction of north. So this is the situation in the basin. If you look south, and we have power from south, we change the balance in Europe. For this reason, is important North Africa in this moment. Gas, energy. And don't consider in this map, we don't see what we have found, what the ANA has found in front of Egypt. This is another migration route. This is a problem. If you look at the migration route in a few moments, you will see that this is the data of the last year. Then I stopped in October because during the winter season, the flood of people is reduced, but we'll start again in March, most probably. When during the bad season, no, a lot of boat people not go across the Mediterranean, but we will happen immediately in the near future. Spring is coming in Europe, and this is a big issue. Look at this map. This is the map of the migration routes from UN. Look at the map, look at the exit point. Are the same exit point of the gas? On the same route of the oil, look at Egypt, Cairo, Greece. Look at Libya, Italy. Look at Nigeria, Mali. And then from Algeria, France, from Morocco to Spain. But the main route is through Italy. For this, from Italy, you center of Mediterranean, you arrive in Italy to the center of Europe. And what I told you before, at the end of the war in Libya, the terrorists that were brought in the area from Turkey will find to exit. Not for sure the money that they gained during the war to open a bar or a pizzeria or a shop in Italy, but probably they have other intention. So we have to be very careful in the flood of the migrants, because in the middle of the migrants, we can have also some of the terrorists. Sorry, wrong direction. Sorry. Again, this is a very significant photo. This is a terrorist. Like, remember the map? And Erdogan is using terrorism to make influence in the area, to have control of the power, to control of the gas, both in Libya, in Nagorno-Karabakh, and in other area where is his interest. So this is very significant. A NATO country is using terrorists, mercenaries in the area where he can gain advantage in the power conflict of empire in gain. Let's go in West Africa. The 2nd of February, France decided to add, this is very important, additional troops in West Africa. Italy also will participate with France in this task force, Matakuba. This task force is more a training force, not a combat force, but for sure in the middle of a training, trainers will have combat forces. Most of these reinforcements would be would be deployed in the border between Mali, Burkina Faso, and Niger. If you close your eyes and come back to the slide of immigration, look at Mali, Burkina Faso, and Niger. It's one of the route of immigration. Then come in Libya. The decision to increase the number of troops deployed in the Sahel Sahara strip of to reach 6,000 soldiers, and this should allow to increase the pressure against the ESS terrorist organization, that is something that is acting on behalf of Daesh in West Sahara. In West Sahara, we have Daesh, still Daesh. France and the supporting country will not leave a space to who want to destabilize the Sahel. The militants have launched a repeated attack against the local troops in Mali and Niger. Mali and Niger, sending area for immigration. France and the government of West and Central Africa agree to a new approach to make this sort of coalition of Sahel to fight the insurgents. It's not only in this area of Sahel. Probably you heard that a couple of days ago, the Italian ambassador in Congo was killed in a terrorist attack. So all Africa destabilized from ISIS, but the Sahel region, in the Sahel region in West Africa, there are a lot of groups, including Al-Qaeda and in the Islamic Maghreb and Daesh. This is very, very important for in the situation. And this is a photo that we always use in Italy to say what is on the other side of Mediterranean in the north of Africa. Daesh is not defeated, is still alive, and they are still working and training. This, sorry if I was a little bit long, but sometimes it's better to tell all. And I always use at the end of my briefing this sentence. Why I was speaking of this? Because all of us, I am an old man of 61 years, but you are younger than me. My interest in the future, what is the future in Mediterranean? Because I have the media of European is 83 years, Japan is a little bit more, I know. But a man lives in Europe 83 years, so I have at least added 22 years in my future. And I'm interested to live properly these next 22 years. Thanks a lot again for your attention and ready to answer your question.
Thank you very much, General Morabito, for your excellent presentation and overview of Italian affairs. We now know how important Italy is in the African affairs, and energy, migration, and terrorism all come through Italy, come through Libya to Italy and then Europe. So, we have still two presentations, but abusing my prerogative as a moderator, can I ask one little but big question? You are looking at Libya from Italy, and you are most close to this peculiar country. In our textbook, world history textbook in the high school, we learn Roman Empire was divided by emperor in the 3rd century. Of course, we all know it was divided into East and West, but on the Mediterranean, southern Mediterranean side, strangely, it's divided between Libya, present-day Libya, Tripoli and Cyrenaica was just the dividing line, dividing, Libya is a Roman Empire, southern, division. So basic historical fact shows us this is very difficult for Libyan modern state to be united, integrated. But from Italian point of view, how do you see this situation? Libya would be, intact, would be kept intact in the, you know, long run as some one entity, or would you expect more, you know, different category other than modern sovereign state? You know, how do you foresee? You know, it's a very good, you know, big question, but I just want to ask you, you know, you're from looking at from Italy.
Okay, thanks a lot for your question. First of all, don't forget the Libya, Syria are Latin name given from the Roman, but the area is important. When you speak of Libya, you speak a territory that is not the historical territory, but was decided at the end of the Second World War. And if you look to the borders, are a straight line, no? Because we're drawn at the end of the Second World War. So the border between, and Syed can be more generous with me in explanation, between Egypt and Syria was drawn at the end of the war, but more probably they divided family or group or clan. For the future of Libya, you have to consider that in Libya there are 142 clans that were unified with the stick and the carrots, using the system of the Brits during at the end of the Second World War from Gaddafi. Gaddafi, using the power, was able to keep together this more than 100 clans, and the country was at a sort of imposed cohesion at that time. Now there is freedom. Is it, in my opinion, this is not the Italian position, is it my personal opinion, it's very difficult to find a solution. It's a dream to consider the opportunity to have election in Libya in the near future. They were expecting to have election in January 2023. But if you have boots on the ground from nation, from army, from other nation, you want to have the control. You want to, there is no central authority that can organize the reconstruction. There is no central organization that distribute on the ground to all 142 clans the money that come in the country because of the selling of the oil is a big issue. I don't see in the near future, a unified Libya in my opinion, is impossible. It's more possible, but it's not what looks at what is the intention of Europe. It's more possible a division of Libya in two countries, and one side under the influence of Egypt, and the other side of the influence of Turkey or other country. This is more probably, or will be a fact in without any UN decision. In this moment, the high representative of UN for Libya is trying to find a solution for a democratic election. But in my opinion, a country with 142 clans, each clan has a little army, a little economic system, a little population, will be unified hardly. I don't expect to see Libya unified before my death. So I will not live enough to see Libya unified. This is my theory. And this is a big issue, but there is no chance to have a unified Libya. It's only a dream. I hope to have answered your question.
Okay, thank you very much for your you know, explanation. And it's really, really helpful for us to grasp the entire situation. We have still two very heavy presentations. So we thank you very much, General Marabit, and we move on to the next presentation by Dr. John Saiko on new jihadist threat.